I told you earlier that there were 20 Orthodox Jews who had come to understand that Jesus of Nazareth was their long-awaited Jewish Messiah, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and they had received him as their Messiah, and they're now attending a Baptist church of 5,000 people in Mexico City called Mount Zion Baptist Church. It's in the front row there. It's quite a scene. They're together. They come with their prayer shawls and their yarmulkes and their tzitzi and their prayer books, and they're drinking in the word of the God of Israel into their souls. And behind them are these 5,000 dear Mexican people, and they're looking at them, and they're wondering, who are they? And after a while, they probably look at them, they're wondering, who are they? And everybody's wondering, who is each other? And I had this experience. I went to church for the first time 40 years ago, and I thought to myself, well, I guess I've become a Gentile now. But I realized that's not what the Bible says. And so I want to address this. Did they become Gentiles? What happened? And the answer is really given to us in a passage in Romans chapter 11 where Paul addresses this. And it's interesting. I want you to read this here a little bit in Romans chapter 11 because he says here, let's start here in verse 1. Paul asks this question. He's writing to a Gentile church called the Church of Rome in Romans, and he says to them, let me raise a question with you. I say then, has God cast away his people? That's a question. You know, the verse before that, I mentioned to you earlier, it said that God says, to Israel he saith, all day long I have stretched forth my hands unto a disobedient and a gainsaying people. So now, if God's stretching forth his hand to a disobedient and a gainsaying people, then right away the natural question is, they're not responding. So the question is, all right, has God cast away his people? That's the question. And Paul says, God forbid. No, God forbid. And then as I mentioned, Paul presents himself and he says, I'm exhibit A, for I also am an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not cast away his people, which he foreknew. But then you look around and you say, but everybody who believes in the Lord Jesus Christ seems like they're Gentiles. They're not Jews. In fact, I don't even see Jews that believe. It's an odd one like me or somebody else around here. But in fact, after I first became a Christian, I thought, well, I'm the only Jew that ever got saved. And then I found the Apostle Paul and I said, all right, second one. But then he says, Paul goes on to say, what? Ye not what the scripture saith of Elias or Elijah? How he makes intercession to God against Israel, saying, Lord, they have killed thy prophets and dig down thine altars, and I am left alone, and they seek my life. So in other words, Elijah, he was actually interceding against Israel because they were after him. And so he was saying, oh God, look what they've done. They've killed your prophets. They dig down your altars, and I'm the only one, Lord. I'm the only one. I'm left alone, and now they're after me. They're seeking my life. Then he says in verse 4, but what saith the answer of God unto him? What did God say when Elijah said that? And God said, Elijah, your eyesight, and I'm paraphrasing, your eyesight and my eyesight, not the same. Your math, my math, not the same. He said this, sorry. He said, I have reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. Elijah's count zero, God's count 7,000. And then he says this principle. Paul says, even so then, at this present time also, there is a remnant according to the election of grace. It's a very small part. What's a remnant? Well, you know, a remnant, you got a big, huge piece of material, and you got a little piece left. That's the remnant. He said, there's a remnant left, a little piece at this present time. And he says, and it's according to the election of grace. And if by grace, then it's no more of works. Otherwise, grace is not grace. But if it's of works, then it's no more grace. Otherwise, work is no more work. Then he says in verse 7, What then? Israel hath not attained. They didn't obtain that which he seeketh for. They didn't get what God wanted them to get. But the election obtained it. The remnant attained it. And the rest were blinded. According as it is written, God hath given to them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see, ears that they should not hear, unto this present day. And David said, let their table be made a snare, and a trap, and a stumbling block, and a recompense unto them. Let their eyes be darkened, that they may not see, and bow down their back always. David said, let their snare table be made a snare. Kind of interesting. Whenever I go to many, many Jewish people, and I say, have you sinned? Oh, yeah, I ate the cheeseburger. Cheeseburger? Yeah, that was a terrible sin. I ate the cheeseburger. Shouldn't eat the cheeseburger. Why is it a sin? Because I ate the dairy and the meat together. It was a sin. You can't eat the dairy and the meat together. Why? Because of the milk of flesh law, because of the dietary law. You can't eat milk and meat together. It's a sin. It's not in the Bible. It's not in the Bible. It's taken from a misconstruction of a verse where God told the Israelites, look, when the harvest begins, don't do like the heathen do. The heathen milk out the mother, and then they boil the kid in its mother's milk to appease the gods. Don't do that. He just said, don't do that, but bring your first fruits into the temple. Well, it's been misconstrued to think that you can't eat milk, you can't eat flesh together. It's not what it means, because in the belly, it's not what it means. But it's become a snare to them. Why? When you go back to the Psalms, where this is referring to, back here, where David is referring to this psalm, in Psalm 69, 22, it says, they gave me vinegar and gall for my drink. And you remember that happened on the cross. And then it says, let their table become a snare to them. It's really a judgment. But anyway, this is part of what happened. And then it says in verse 11, I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? No. God says, God forbid, but rather through their fall, salvation has come to the Gentiles. It's wonderful. And that's what happened with the case of Joseph. Because when Joseph was sold into Egypt, how about all those nations that came to Joseph and got fed? But through their fall, salvation has come to the Gentiles, for to provoke them to jealousy. Why are these Gentiles saying they have 100% assurance that they're going to heaven when they die? I don't. They're talking about my Bible, the Jewish Bible. They're talking about my Messiah, the Jewish Messiah. I'm jealous. What do they got that I don't have? And then it says in verse 12, if the fall of them be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? For I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I also, Paul speaking, and the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify my office. If by any means I may provoke to emulation them which are my flesh, and might save some of them. For if the casting away of them be the reconciling of the world, what shall the receiving of them be but life from the dead? If the first fruits be holy, the lump also is holy, and the root is holy, so are the branches. Branches. We're talking about a root. We're talking about branches. For if some of the branches, we're talking about a Jewish plant, a branches, be broken off, thou being a wild olive tree, thou Gentile being a wild olive tree, wert grafted in among them, and with them partakest of the root and fatness of the olive tree. Boast not thyself against the branches. But if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root thee. Thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off, that I might be grafted in. Well, because of unbelief, thou wert broken off. Thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed. Now, we've got a picture here of two olive trees. A natural olive tree representing Israel, the Jewish nation, the root being the Lord Jesus Christ himself, the Jewish Messiah, the branches coming off of him. And we have another olive tree, the Gentile olive tree, called the wild olive tree. And we have something in the Bible here talked about a grafting process. How does this work? Well, here we have two olive trees. We're going to call this one, a little straighter, the natural olive tree. This is the Israel olive tree. This is the Jewish olive tree. The Lord Jesus Christ being the root and the central branch here, and the branches coming off of him. The olive tree, the natural olive tree. Over here, we have the wild olive tree, the Gentile wild olive tree. Here it is right here. There they are. So let's see, how does this work as far as the analogy is given to us in Scripture? Well, first of all, we come over here to this one. I'm going to interview the branches. So somebody comes to this branch, and this person, this is the branch right here, and it says, and he's in the straight natural Jewish Israel olive tree, with the root being the Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. Someone comes to him and says, Jesus of Nazareth was the Jewish Messiah, the long-awaited one, the one prophesied by the Scriptures. You, like everybody, are a sinner, and he died for your sins so that you could be redeemed and go to heaven. Now, this person listens and he says, and we hear him carefully, and he says, you know what? I believe. I know I'm a sinner. I know. I feel so ashamed. I feel so guilty. I've been looking for this redemption. I've been looking for this cleansing. I've been looking for relief from the burden of the guilt and that I've been going with for so long. I am so found now. I am fulfilled. I'm complete. I found finally my God. I found who God is. I found he is Jesus, the Jewish Messiah. I am in him. I am saved. And God says, and you are. He stays within the straight olive tree where the root is the Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, then we come to this other person and we say, Isaiah said, all we like sheep have gone astray. We turned everyone, that includes you, to his own way. And God laid on the Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, the iniquity of us all. And all you have to do is put your faith and trust in him, and he will save you from your sins. And this person responds, well, I understand what you're saying, but my mother died, my father died. And when they died, they said to me, promise me, you will never, never, never turn to another religion. You will especially never go to a church. You will never marry somebody who's not Christian. Promise me. That's why I can go to my grave and always have confidence that you will do that. So even though I understand what you're saying, even though it may be true, I will not believe. And God says, I heard that. And God takes his shears. And he says, I have to now, because you said, I will not believe. Cut you out of the tree. And he cuts it out. And then we come to another person and we say to him, we found him, Jesus of Nazareth. It's the person who the prophets wrote of. It's the person who Moses wrote of. He came and fulfilled all the prophecies. Look, he was born in Bethlehem. Look, he was born of a virgin. Look, he died on a cross like it says in Isaiah 53 and Psalm 22. We found him. We found him. And now it's time to just be saved and look to him and live. And this person responds, I'm married to a Jewish spouse. I work in a Jewish business. My community are all Jews. Jews don't believe in Christ. We can't even say the name. I can't even consider what you're saying. I can't even think about it. I have to close myself. There is no way. I would lose too much. I'm sorry, but I will not believe. And God takes his pruning shears and he says, I cut you out of the natural tree. And he puts them over here on this side. And we come to another Jewish person. And we say to him, look, look, your life is miserable. You have no purpose. You have an emptiness. You have a big giant hole in your heart. I know you're making a lot of money. I know you've got everything you can buy, but there's such an insecurity in you. And God came to give you purpose. God came to fill that big, fat, giant hole in your heart. He said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. And he wants to do it. He wants to save you. He wants to be your fulfillment. And his name is, guess what? The Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. And all you have to do is confess your sin and receive him as your Lord and Savior and live for him. That's all you have to do. And this person responds back, yes, but I love my life. I got everything I want. When I have a desire, I fulfill it. I'm not going to have anybody rule over me. God's not going to rule. God, the master of my life? Bye-bye, God. No way. You want me to become straight? No, I will not believe. God hears that, and he cuts him off. Then, here comes somebody over in down into Mexico, down to the south, into Chiapas, to an Indian village. And this person's from Chiapas. And he says to the person in Chiapas, the Bible says, all have sinned, even you, and have come short of the glory of God. You have sinned. Sin is disobeying God who made you. The Bible says there is judgment for sin, and that judgment is eternity in hell, in a lake of fire, with no relief and no escape. But the Bible says God so loved you that he gave his only begotten Son. He's a Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, that whosoever, that means you, believes in him, you don't have to perish. You can have everlasting life. You can become a child of God today. He died for your sins. What is your response? And this person says, I'm so happy. I've been waiting for this all my life. What took you so long to get here? And he's jumping up and down. And he says, yes, 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 into my heart. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Save me today. And God hears that. And he says, okay, I'm going to cut you out of the natural olive tree. And then God goes and gets duct tape. And he takes the duct tape. And he takes them over here and he grafts them into the natural olive tree. And he didn't even know it. But now he's partaking of the root and the fatness of the Jewish Messiah. He's actually in his heart become a Jew. He doesn't know it. He still looks like a Chapin, doesn't look Jewish. But he's now, as far as God sees, he says, I see you in the natural olive tree. I see you as grafted in. I see you as a Jew in your heart. And everybody's happy. Chapin weighs a little bit, but he'll lose some weight. And then come over to the next one over here. And this person is in Ethiopia, and he's in a mud hut. And he was just born one day, and someone said to him, you're a Muslim. He goes, oh, I'm a Muslim. And what one day, he's sitting there thinking, I don't know how I'm going to get to heaven. I can't really be sure. All I can do is hope. I don't like living in this insecurity. And some Ethiopian Christian comes to him and says, let me show you in the book of God, what God did for you. And he says to him, in that while you were yet a sinner, Christ, the Messiah, died for your sins. He died on a cross for your sins. He took all of your guilt. He took all of the wrong things that you said you thought you did. He took it on himself. He paid that price. He poured out his blood, and he died for you so that your slate and your crime sheet could be wiped absolutely clean. And if you come to the Lord Jesus Christ and receive this gift, because it's a gift, and God's holding out the gift, and he says, I give you salvation, all you have to do with your heart is receive it. What is your response? And he thinks about it, and he says, yes, yes, that God, my God, yes, I take that gift as best I know how. Lord, I'm a sinner. Lord, come into my heart. Lord, save me from my sins. And that Ethiopian man in that mud hut becomes a child of God by faith, by receiving the Jewish Messiah. And you know what happens? God comes along and he cuts that person out of that branch, out of that tree, and he takes him over here, Ethiopian former black Muslim. And God takes more duct tape and he grafts him in to the natural olive tree. And he says, whether you know it or not, now you have become a Jew in your heart. You are now grafted in and taking part of the natural olive tree with his fatness and his goodness, and the root is the Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. But then something starts to happen. These branches over here start to move. Starts to move around. I got to listen to what he says. And the branch says, I was wrong. I was so wrong. How could I have been so foolish, so stupid? I overcounted the cost. I overrated it. I said, it's not worth it. I knew I would give up my inheritance. I knew they might disown me. But now I see God is worth it. Now I see the inheritance that God has promised to me in the Bible is worth it. Now I see my need. Now I see the goodness of God. Now I understand. I've been reading and I saw that Moses, they were in the wilderness, and because of their disobedience and the snakes bit the Israelites and they were dying, and God told Moses, just make a serpent on a pole and hold it up and only look and live. And now I want to look and live, and I do look and live, and I repent and I turn and I receive Jesus of Nazareth as my Lord and Savior. I embrace him. And God's so happy. And he says, all right. And God loves to go get that duct tape again. And he takes it out and he says, we're grafting you back. And he goes back to the branch here, to the natural one. He says, now you're grafted back in. And it's a great day. That's the analogy that God gives for us to understand. The natural olive tree, the wild olive tree, God's listening for the response of each person. What will you do with Jesus? What will your answer be? Someday, you will be asking, what will he do with me? But now is a time of decision. You know, when the servant of Abraham came to get the bride for Isaac, Rebekah, and it was a big, huge party, and Laban was there, and there was gold going around, and the servant was talking about the riches of his father Abraham, and how he came to seek a bride for Isaac, and he was making the proposal to Rebekah, and everybody was talking and giving their opinion. Should Rebekah go? Should not Rebekah go? And finally, Rebekah comes in, and it was as if everybody said, everybody, please stop. Silence, please. And the question was asked, Rebekah, will you go with this man? Rebekah was the only one who could answer. And Rebekah said, I'll go. That was her decision. Whenever God's gift of salvation is presented, God designs it. It's not automatic. It's not automatic. Nobody makes that decision for you. You make it for yourself. God doesn't even make that decision for you. You make it for yourself. Because God so wonderfully crowns each one of us with the sovereignty of choice. And he says, now, we're going to step back, we're going to present, then we're all going to step back, and we're going to hear and record what your decision is. And Rebecca made that decision, and she therefore went and became the bride and the wife of Isaac. And each one of these, whether it's a wild olive tree, natural olive tree or a wild olive tree, had their moment when God presented to them the offer of salvation. Will you acknowledge your sin? It's not a question of whether or not you are a sinner, it's a question of whether or not you'll acknowledge. Will you acknowledge? Will you confess to God? Will you say from your heart, I am a sinner? Will you then turn and say, I need a Savior, not just any Savior, but the Savior, the Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ? Will you do that? And then everybody stands back, and God says, I am listening. And the response determines the destiny. The response determines the eternity. The response determines between life and death, heaven and hell. That's what it's all about. And God's, when he hears whether Jew, whether Gentile who rejects, they will not be in the natural olive tree. It'll be a separation. But when God hears, yes, I will take the free gift of salvation. The Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, died for me. He will be my lamb. I will. Then God says, if Jewish, first time through, you stay. If Gentile, first you get grafted into. But then, as long as there's breath in our lungs, God says, I'm patient. Like Joseph, I'm patient. I can wait. I've given you a space of life. The appointment with death hasn't come yet. When it does, then it is appointed unto man once to die, after that the judgment, then it's finished. But until that time comes, I love repentance, God says. I love a change of mind. I love a change of heart. I love when a person comes and says, I was wrong, I'm turning around. What's repentance? Repentance is like you're walking along, you're in the army. God says, halt, you halt. God says, about face, you make it about face. God says, march, you march. It's turning around. God says, I love that. I'll call to you every day. I'll put every roadblock in your way. I'll be patient as you climb over those roadblocks, as you break your way down. I'll wait for you until you finally do come. And when you come, then I'm going to go and save you and forgive you for all the rebellion that you've had. And then I will love to take you and graft you into safety, into me, the natural olive branch, olive tree, and you will be a branch in me. That's the meaning of John 15. I am the vine, you are the branches. Without me, you can do nothing. Oh, how wonderful our God is that he's that way. That's our God. Our God is a God of patience, but there is a limit to the patience. And so our God is also a God of warning. And he says, today, that means today, if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart. Respond to him. Do not harden your heart. Do not be rebellious, because God promises in the first chapter of the book of Isaiah, when he speaks about Israel, he says, hear, O heavens, verse 2, chapter 1, verse 2, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken, I have nourished and brought up children, and they have rebelled against me. The ox knoweth his owner, the ass his mother's crib, but Israel doth not know, my people doth not consider. You know what that is a definition of? Prejudice. Will not consider. Well, yeah, it's true, you're the best man for the job, but, can't be considered. Well, yeah, I see there's a lot of things written about, your name is Jesus, sorry, can't consider. God says, don't be like that. Don't be like that. Because when a person closes their heart and will not consider because of prejudice, God calls that rebellion. And therefore, he says in verse 4, ah, sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors. They've forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger. They are gone away backward. But then, oh, how wonderful. God says in verse 9, yeah, it's bad, yeah, but he says, except the Lord of hosts had left unto us a very small remnant, we should have been like unto Sodom and Gomorrah. What's he talking about? Well, in Abraham's day, when God was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, Abraham bargained with God and said, oh, God, I know you want to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, but God, let's just kind of wait a little bit here. How about if we find 50 righteous people? Will you save the city? He said, I'll save for 50. Well, God, listen, I don't want to push it too much, but can we go down to 45? Can I get 5 off? I'm just 5. 45, are you good for 45? God said, I'm good for 45. Well, God, okay, how about 40? Can we go 40? Please, God, 40? I'll go 40. Abraham pushes a little bit. God, listen, I know I'm pushing it, but 10, can I get 10? 30? 30, God says, okay, 30. I'll spare the city for 30. God, listen, another time, please. 10 more, God, 20? I'll spare the city for 20. God, last time, promise. God says, I'm holding you to this, Abraham. God, 10 more, 10. Will you spare the city for 10? God said, that's it, Abraham. I will spare the city for 10. We're done. What was all that about? God was saying there in that, and Abraham understood it, if there's a very small remnant within the whole, God will spare the city. God will spare the nation. Now, most Jewish people today look at those who are Jews, like myself, others, who have received the Lord Jesus Christ, and they say, oh, you're the problem. As a matter of fact, it's documented just before the concentration camps that there was a fair number of Jews who turned to the Lord Jesus Christ beforehand. The rabbi said, that's why the judgment came. God says, opposite. They're preserving the nation. They're the remnant. And so God says, there is a remnant today that's preserving the whole nation. And then he says, even though the condition they're in verse 16, he says to Israel, wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your eyes. And then he says in verse 18, come now. Can you imagine God saying, come? He said in another place, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. He says, come now. He said, let's reason together. Let's sit down and talk this through, saith the Lord. Your side, he says, though your sins be as scarlet, they'll be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they'll be as wool. How's that a deal for you? You come with the need, I come with the solution. Your sin, I'll take care of it. Then he says, if you be willing, and if you are obedient, you'll eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you'll be devoured. The mouth of the sword, the sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. That's God's call. I know you're a sinful nation. I know you're rebellious. Come now, let's reason together. I'll clean you. I'll make you white as snow. Just come. Come with your sin. You say, how can I come? I don't know how to come. God says, I'll help you. If you search me with all your heart, you'll find me. You'll find me, he says. He says, you got to come. I'll show you something in the book of Hosea here, if I can find it. It was in here yesterday. Should still be here. There it is. Book of Hosea. He says, last chapter, verse 14. God's going through with Hosea. He says about the people. He says, you're not my people, lo ami, and tells them all the sin that they've done. And then he says in chapter 14, verse 1, he said, oh, Israel, return unto the Lord thy God, for thou hast fallen by thine iniquity. So let me just pause there. And so they may say, how can we return? We don't know how to do it. We're not religious. We don't know what to do. God says, I'll help you. He says in verse 2, take with you words and turn to the Lord. Say unto him, take away all iniquity and receive us graciously. So will we render the calves of our lips. You know what God's giving there? A salvation prayer for them. I'll give you the sinner's prayer. Lord, out of my heart, stand, you bring as much as your heart as you can. Turn to me. Take me seriously. Just come. He says, I don't know what to say. Just say this. Take away our iniquity. And God said, I'll do the rest. You move 1 millimeter, I'll move 1,000 miles for you. That's God. He wants to forgive you. Hell was not created for man. It was created for the devil and his angels. Man only fights his way into it out of rebellion. Because God doesn't want to send any man to hell. He wants to save every man. And he's doing everything he can. He made the way open. He's pleading. He's holding out his arms all day long. He tells you what to do. Just come. Just come. Seek him with all the heart that you have. Take with you words. Turn to him and say, God, we haven't spoken. I don't know how to do this, but I'm trying the best I can. You said take away iniquity. That's my prayer. Take away my iniquity. He said, I'll take care of you. I'll take care of you. That's God. What a wonderful Savior we have in the Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's yearning for you, and he wants you. He made you. He lost you. He found you. Now he wants to buy you by your decision to receive him and for you to become a child of God. A child of God. You know, the great chapters that really describe to us about Israel's past, present, and future in the Bible are Romans 9, 10, 11. We've already covered the ones here about the grafting in, which is a very, very important part in the history here as regard to what's really going on, as I mentioned. But Romans 9 also tells us that, and again, Paul is describing Jews to a Gentile church, the Roman church, and he starts off from Romans 8, which, by the way, Romans 8 is the Holy Spirit chapter in the Bible. There's more mentions of the Holy Spirit, in chapter 8 than the whole rest of the book of Romans. And so coming off of the presence of the Holy Spirit, he moves right into chapter 9. It's almost as if you know, there was one apostle who put his head closest to the Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. That was the Apostle John. He laid his head on his chest. He heard the heartbeat. And it's almost like Paul here in this case has laid his head on the chest of the Jewish Messiah in chapter 8. Hearing the heartbeat, he comes off. And we say, Paul, what's your words as you come off? And he starts off chapter 9. He says, I say the truth in Christ. I lie not. What is it, Paul? My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost. What is it? I have great heaviness, continual sorrow in my heart, for I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh, who are Israelites. What? You got close to God and you heard a burden for Israel? You got close to God and you heard a heartache for Israel? You got close to God and your heart got broken for the Jewish people? Yes, he says, for the Israelites. He says, to whom pertaineth the adoption? They had the adoption, they had the glory, they had the covenants, they had the giving of the law, they had the service of God, they had the promises. Whose are the fathers and of whom is concerning the flesh? Christ came, the Messiah came. He's over all. God bless forever. Amen. I said, wow, Paul, so what happened? All this happened, but nothing happened. He said, well, it's not as though the word of God didn't take any effect, he says in verse 6. I don't get it, Paul. Would you please explain it a little better? Listen to the principle, he says. They are not all Israel which are of Israel. What? Listen again. They are not all Israel which are from Israel. Paul, please explain. All right. Verse 7. Neither, Paul's saying, catch the words. Neither because they are the seed, please mark, seed of Abraham, are they all children of Abraham. I'm sorry, Paul, can you go over that one more time? Yes. Neither because they are all the seed are they all children. Wait, isn't that the same, Paul? No, No. Seed and children. Okay, Paul, can you explain that a little bit better? Yes. Verse 7. But in Isaac shall thy seed be called. That's what it says back in Genesis. In Isaac. Not all of Isaac, but within Isaac shall thy seed be called. Right? And this is the word of promise. At this time will I come and Sarah will have a son. And not only this, he says, verse 10, when Rebekah also conceived by one, even by our father Isaac, she had twins, Esau and Jacob, the children having not yet born, neither having done good or evil, the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth, it was said, the elder shall serve the younger. Drop down. It says here, keeping on with this, here, it says here, verse 24, even us, whom he hath called, not of Jews only, but also of Gentiles. As he saith in Hosea, I will call them my people, which are not my people, and her beloved, which is not my beloved. And it shall come to pass in the place where it was said, you are not my people, that was Hosea, there shall they be called the children of the living God. Isaiah also crieth concerning Israel, though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, a remnant shall be saved. Again, this theme, a remnant in Isaac, not all Israel, a seed, children. What's this seed and children thing all about? You go back to John chapter 8. And there was a certain discussion that took place between the Jewish Messiah and the Jewish rulers and leaders and religious leaders of those days. And the discussion was, who are we? And so they answered him, they were wanting to kill him, and they said, we be Abraham's seed. And we're never in bondage, so forth. They said, we be Abraham's seed. They used the word seed. Then, verse 37 says, I know you are Abraham's seed. No question. I know you're Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me. Then they said, in verse 39, Abraham is our father. And he said, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. He said, you, Abraham's seed? No contest, yes. You, Abraham's children? No. You're not doing the works of Abraham. Why? Remember this branch? This branch said, my mother, my father, my family, my business, I will not leave them. Even though God may be calling me, I will not leave them. Remember Abraham? God said to Abraham, Abraham, leave your father, leave your kindred, leave your community, leave your land, come to me. Remember what Abraham did? He left. Who's the child of Abraham? A Jewish person who hears God say, I know your family rejects me, leave your family. I know your kindred says you're not allowed to receive me as your Savior. Leave them. I'm more important than your family. A child of Abraham follows the works of Abraham. The seed of Abraham is just birth. A child of Abraham is choice. There is a difference between a Jew by birth and a Jew by choice. Let me explain. Where do we get this name Jew? Where does that come from? It's really named after one of the sons of Jacob, Judah. As a matter of fact, in Hebrew, you don't say the word Jew. You say Judah. For example, if you have a group of Jews in Israel coming along and you say, oh, look, here comes these group of, you don't say Jews. You say, here comes these group of Judahs coming over to us. Here's a Judah. There's a Judahs. We're Judahs. It's the word Judah. It's been shortened. We don't say that in English. We just take the short form and we say Jew. Oh, why do we call him Judah? Remember? when Jacob was on his deathbed, he knew the most important person that will ever be born is going to come through my children. One of these 12 is going to be God, who became a man through one of my children. I want to name myself and orient myself toward that event. Therefore, I will be that person. Was it Joseph? No. We're not called Josephs. Was it Levi? No. We're not called Levies. Levy, some of us are. Anyway, was it called Ashkelon? No, we're not called Ashkelonish, and so forth. But on his deathbed, he realized, oh, Judah, it's you. Zayata, it's you, Judah. You're the one. Messiah's going to come through you. And when that was spoken and everybody realized it, then the nation oriented themselves toward that person and they became known as Judah's Jews. And what it meant in essence was that if you called yourself a Jew by choice, not by birth, is that, look, little boy, you're a Jew. Okay, I'm a Jew. Oh, what is he going to say? But when you come to a part in your time, when you make your own decision, supposed to be the time, accountability, maybe it's 13, like your bar mitzvah, and the best mitzvah you can do on your day of mitzvah is to receive the Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. But on that day, you said, now I am a Jew. That means that you put your faith and trust in the Jewish Messiah, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Judah. And you become a Jew, inwardly, by choice, different by birth. When he said, I know you're the seed of Abraham. Yeah, you're Jews by birth. You're the seed of Abraham. But you're not the children of Abraham. If you were the children of Abraham, you'd receive me because I am the Messiah from Judah. And there's a difference between being a Jew inwardly and being a Jew outwardly. Sometimes, if you look in John chapter 1, we have a lot of confusion when we talk about the word Christian. What does Christian mean? It's very clear, because here in John chapter 1, it says very clearly, in 40-41, we have found the Messiah. The Messiah. We found the Messiah, which is being interpreted the Christ. Messiah means Christ. That's what it means. Messiah means Christ. Christ is Greek. Messiah, Hebrew, Mashiach, they're the same name. So when you become a Christian, you're becoming a Messiah in. As a matter of fact, in Hebrew, they don't call them Christians, they call them Meshkis. A Messiah in. When you become a Jew inside, you orient yourself toward the Messiah. They're one and the same. A Jew who is a Jew inwardly, who orients himself toward the Messiah of Judah, the Jewish Messiah, Yeshua, the Lord Jesus Christ, he is a Jew inwardly. When a Gentile comes and receives the Jewish Messiah, who he calls Christ, which is the same word as Messiah, he becomes a Christian, he becomes a Messiah, and he becomes a Jew inwardly. That's why he gets grafted into the natural branches here, because now he's a Jew inwardly. They're one and the same. So therefore God said to him that if you were the child of Abraham, you'd be a Jew inwardly by choice, and you'd receive me. So when you become as a Jew, when you receive Christ as your Savior, what's happening? You become a Gentile, you no longer become a Jew. No. You become a Jew by choice, because in essence, you're receiving the Jewish Messiah, the Jewish Messiah of Judah. And so you become a Jew inside, just like the Gentiles who receive Christ become a Jew inside, and you're one, no longer different. You look different, depends on where you're born. You might be, it doesn't matter. It depends on where you're born. But inwardly, in heart, new family, new community, new father, new life, new heaven. Thank God. Please pray with me. Lord Jesus, I'm one of those sheep. I went astray. I turned to my way. I'm a sinner. I'm hell-bound. I hate it. But, oh God, I thank you. I thank you, Father, that you sent your Son to be the Lamb of God. I thank you, Father, that it pleased you to bruise him. You put him to grief. You sacrificed your Son. I thank you, Father, that now you invite me to make his soul my offering for sin. I thank you, Father. I want to be a child of God. I want to have eternal life. I want to be forgiven. I want him to bear my iniquities. I want you to use me. Lord, I receive the Jewish Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, as my Lamb of God, who died for my sins. Count me in, Lord. Sign me up. I receive him now as my personal Lamb of God who died for me. I understand he rose from the dead. I understand that you're satisfied. I'll live for him who died for me. I open my heart to do these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.